Welcome, welcome once again to Monday Night Bible Study. We're happy that you could make it this evening. I'm glad that you're here. Why don't you get somebody to join in with you? Pull your husband, your friend, your wife, your children. Just pull somebody in with you so that we can share this time together. Your best friend, call them and say, tune in, join in with us, because it's time to get into the Word of God. And without any delay tonight, let's pray so we can jump into the Word. Father, we just thank you for everyone who has gathered. We thank you, Father, because you know them by name. You know where they are, and you know exactly what is needed. You've even heard the petitions that they've been whispering to you. And we ask, Lord, that you would meet those needs, physical, spiritual, within the soul, Father, relational, whatever those needs are, I thank you that you are able to supply them. You are able to meet them right where they are, Lord, and bring them to where you have called them to be. So thank you for this moment in time, and we give you praise, glory, and honor in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, let's jump into the Word tonight. We are in 2 Corinthians chapter 13 this evening. Again, get somebody to come in and join in with you. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, faith proof, faith proof. Proof. Won't you say it to yourself tonight? Faith proof. That's where we are. So we know who wrote the book of Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, and we also know that there was an additional letter. It's the Apostle Paul. Paul begins this chapter of this letter with substantive words such as facts, established, proof, examine, and test. So what is Paul referencing which requires such scrutiny and assurance? Paul summarizes this letter with insights regarding topics that he's previously addressed throughout the letter already. He summarizes it. And then he also reminds the local assembly there of his position in their lives. He also invites them to look inside their own lives individually and collectively. So as a result of our study today, we're going to look at what a fact is. What is a fact, and how does that relate to a subject or an event? What is the significance of having two or three witnesses concerning a testimony? What does it mean for something to be established? What is the purpose of and for an examination? What is the outcome of a test? Passed, failed? Something else? Let's look at that. And also, why does the Apostle Paul instruct the believers there at Corinth to examine and test themselves? So again, as a result of our time to get together today, we are praying and we expect that each of us will better grasp the intention of this chapter and understand ways to personally apply it to our lives. So are you ready? Let's get in with the warm-up. You know, we got to stretch sometimes. We got to move our arms. Sometimes you need to jog in place or walk just to get everything flowing. So we're going to flow with a reminder tonight about Corinth. What is Corinth? Corinth was a settlement that turned into a city and also served as a trade center. If you want to think about that, you can think about a modern-day New York, maybe on the west coast of San Francisco and L.A., or maybe a Miami. And we know what kind of goes on in those cities. And so if we can think of those cities, we can think about what's going on in Corinth. Corinth was near Athens, Greece, about 43 miles from Athens. And it was known also because it had a large naval fleet. They had large buildings, and it was a wealthy city, a lot of well-to-do people there in the city. Well, Corinth was also captured by the Romans, captured and burned by the Romans at one point, and the women and children were sold into slavery. But then it was refounded by Julius Caesar. Many of you know who Julius Caesar is, Emperor of Rome. So he refounded the city at one point. Corinth was also known for a famous temple that it had, the Temple of Aphrodite. Now, Aphrodite was known as the goddess of love. So within this temple dedicated to Aphrodite, there were thousands, not just hundreds, not just tens, but there were thousands of highly educated temple prostitutes who also acted as artists and entertainers. So again, you can imagine this metropolitan city, they had this large temple, and it influenced the hearts and the minds of the people that were there. There were also cultural influences from the Greeks, the Hellenistic influence, from the Romans, and also from the Jews who had also settled there. So Paul goes into this metropolitan area, this big complex, this area known with lots of wealth, lots of entertainment, lots of happenings going on, and he establishes a church there. God sends him there with his direction, and Paul stays there for about 18 months, pouring into the people, preaching the good news of the gospel of the kingdom and of Jesus Christ. He's working there to build and establish lives. And then he moves on to another city. But while he goes on to other cities, he checks in on the people there because he's connected to them. Even when he was in Ephesus, he would write a letter to the people at Corinth. And again, like we said, he wrote two or three letters, three or more actually, that I believe that he did write. But Paul was maintaining a presence in the lives of the individuals because he cared for them and cared about the work of God that was going on there. And in so doing, he challenged believers to grow in the knowledge of Christ and who he had called them to be. He was constantly communicating with them, letting them know you're not your own. You've been bought with a price. You've been set free from what you used to be, and now you're on the road to who God has called you to be. He also confronted situations, and we saw that. You can go back to some of the other teachings on this series. He confronted situations with work to diminish the work of Christ collectively and individually. He loved the church, and he loved those who comprised the church. And in doing so, he also attracted haters, and we talked about that in previous sessions. So go back and look at that and see who were the haters who did not like what Paul was doing. So now we warmed up, we got our review, we understand what Corinth is and what's going on. And again, go back and reference some of the previous sessions to get you caught up to date. But now let's look at this chapter. Let's get into our workout. So Paul entreats the locals there with apostolic love and admonition. He's writing to them, and one of the first things he says, but we're not going to go through the first five or six verses. We're going to jump down to verse 7 right here. And Paul says, first off, do the right thing. Do the right thing. Come on, and say, wherever you are right now, come on, say that out loud so you can hear it. Do the right thing. Come on, say it one more time. Do the right thing. So Paul prays that the believers will not refuse his correction. Let's look at verse 7, 2 Corinthians 13, verse 7, and we'll be reading from the New Living Translation. Paul says, he writes this, "We pray to God that you will not do what is wrong by refusing our correction. I hope we won't need to demonstrate our authority when we arrive. Do the right thing before we come, even if that makes it look like we have failed to demonstrate our authority." So Paul here in writing, again, he's demonstrating, I'm addressing these issues because I love you. He's not going to let it just die off or die from the lack of attention because it's not going to die. He's addressing it. And then Paul is, because of who he is and because of his relationship with God, and God called him and appointed him to be the apostle, he is God the Father's extension to the people here in this regard. And so he said, our Heavenly Father loves you so much, and his word lets us know that he chastens those whom he loves. God disciplines those whom he loves. So let's look at that in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 6. It says, "For the Lord disciplines those he loves And he punishes each one he accepts as his child. Why do parents do that? Because they see the potential. They see the right road in which a child is supposed to go. And so they make intervention and they make interruptions in order to get them back on the right road. Discipline is not necessarily for punishment. It is for correction in thought processes, in behaviors. And that's what Paul is doing. And Paul also lets them know, even in this verse, he is not looking to make a name or a reputation for himself, but only for God. Did you catch the end of that verse? It says, even if it makes it look like we have failed to demonstrate our authority. So at the risk of looking weak, and we also know that they all thought, many, and I'm not going to say all, many of them thought that Paul was weak when he was there physically, but he was awful strong when he was hiding behind the pen. So even at the risk of looking weak, Paul admonishes the believers to not delay in making things right before he comes. Do the right thing even before I come. So how do we personally apply this? Well, first of all, we see that Paul is addressing issues that need to be corrected. So we can be quick to repent when we are in error. Be quick to repent. Be quick to repent, repent, repent. Repent means to change, to rethink, to turn from, and to turn to turn from what I was doing, which was wrong, and turn toward and walk in the way that is right. And that requires a shift in perception and in thinking. So be quick to repent when we find out that we are in error. Also, realize that our Heavenly Father loves you. He loves you and I too much to allow us to remain the same in sin and not address it. God is not going to allow us to continue to go off the path, to miss the mark. He is not going to allow us to do that without sending interruptions to get us out, to course correct us along the way. And also we can take from this that ministry to the Lord and His people is never about our appearance and others' perceptions of our abilities. It's never about that. We can't be concerned about what they might think about what I am doing as long as we're focused on doing what is right and what is pleasing to the Lord. Doing what is right and doing what is pleasing to the Lord, even if it makes it look foolish, as Paul has said there, if it makes it look like we failed to demonstrate who we are, the power that we have, the abilities that we have. If what I'm doing and encouraging you to do focuses on you getting right and you pleasing God, it doesn't matter about me looking good in front of everybody else. That's something we all can take away from that. Come on, somebody right where you are, share, it's not about me. It's never about me, but it's all about God. Come on, say it so I can hear you. It's never about me, but it's all about God. All right. So the second thing that Paul hits in verse 8, we're coming up on, he says, don't oppose the truth. So the first thing he said was what? You remember? What was it? There it is. Do the right thing. Do the right thing. Then the second thing he says here is don't oppose the truth. Don't stand in opposition to the truth. Stand for what's right, and in doing so, you oppose the truth. Did you get that? Stand for what is right, and in doing so, you oppose the truth. Let's look at verse 8 there. And he says, we cannot oppose the truth, but must always stand for the truth. He's talking about we, those who are with me, those who are born again, those who are on assignment from the Lord, those who have been called out from and to him, the church. We cannot oppose the truth, but we must always stand for the truth is what he's saying. When we oppose truth or opposing truth, it opens the doorway to deception. Anytime we're in opposition to truth or we refuse to hear truth, refusing to hear is opposing truth. I'll say that again. Refusing to hear truth is opposing truth. So anytime we oppose truth, we open ourselves up to deception. And deception is can be close to the truth, but a little poison on the inside, and it corrupts it all. So anytime we oppose truth, we open the door to deception. And truth is the only antidote to deception. Truth is the antidote to deception. So how do we know truth? I'm glad you asked. Brother Mark, how do I know what's true? You're at the right place at the right time with the right people. We trust God's word for truth. Let's go over to Proverbs chapter 3. Verses 5 and 6. Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. It says this. You there? It's in the Old Testament, about halfway. Whoop. There you go. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek His will in all you do, and He will show you which path to take. We can't lean on our own understanding. We can't lean on our own knowledge. It's limited. Somebody say it's limited. But when we trust God with everything that we are and we delight in Him and we don't depend on our own understanding and we're looking unto Him, if we seek Him who is truth, what does the word says? He will show you which path to take. So truth is found in God's word. Say that out loud. Truth is found in God's word. Say it one more time. Truth is found in God's word. Tell that person over there in the kitchen who's listening in a little bit, tell them, truth is found in God's word. All right, they're going to look up at you. What are you talking about? Just tell them, truth is found in God's word. John 17:17 says this. This is Jesus communicating with the Father. Make them holy by your truth. Make them set apart, unique and different by your truth. Teach them your word, which is truth. This is Jesus praying. He said, Father, teach those that you have given unto me. Teach them your word. Your word is truth. Then Psalm 119, let's go back over there next to Proverbs where you were. Psalm 119, verse 160. Did you know there were 160 verses or more in Psalm 119, the longest quote unquote chapter in the Bible? All right, anyway, verse 160 says this, the very essence of your words is truth. The very essence of your words is truth. All your just regulations will stand forever. The very essence of the words that come from you, God, is truth. So when we want to know truth, we turn to the one who is truth, and He will provide truth unto us. So the Apostle Paul is telling them, first of all, what did he tell them? Do the right thing, Corinth, believers in Corinth. Secondly, what did he tell them? Don't oppose truth. Do the right thing. Don't oppose truth. And do the right thing before we even get there. Don't stand in opposition to the truth that you're receiving from us. Even unbelief is in opposition to truth. So don't believe every report that's coming that you're hearing from the Judaizers and those who are around. Stay in the truth, do the right thing. And then he tells them, establish the facts with proof of your faith. And this is where the meat of our time together is going to be today. We're out of the warm-up. We're in the workout. We're in the workout. We did the workout on doing the right thing. We're in the workout. Don't oppose truth. Now we're working out. We're increasing the intensity of our workout. You ready? You ready? Come on. Some of you might need to jump and get it together. Establish the facts with proof of your faith. Let's look at verse 1 through 6, 2 Corinthians 13. Verse 1. This is the third time I am coming to visit you. Not the first, not the second. And as the scriptures say, the facts, underline facts, of every case must be established, underline established, by the testimony, underline testimony, of two or three witnesses. I have already warned those who had been sinning when I was there on my second visit. Now I again warn them and all others, just as I did before, that the next time I will not spare them. I will give you all the proof that you want that Christ speaks through me. Christ is not weak when he deals with you. He is powerful among you. Although he was crucified in weakness, he now lives by the power of God. We too are weak, just as Christ was. But when we deal with you, we will be alive with him and will have God's power. Then he says in verse 5, examine, underline that, yourselves to see if your faith is genuine. Test, underline that, yourselves. Surely you know that Jesus Christ is among you. If not, you have failed the test of genuine faith. As you test yourselves, I hope you will recognize that we have not failed the test of apostolic authority. And that verse is key right there too, in giving insight to what Paul is talking about here. Establish the facts with proof of your faith. So I asked you to underline several words there. Facts, established, proof, examine, test. All these are key words, substantive words. And let's take a look at that. First of all, he's saying the facts of every case must be established. Facts. What is a fact? What are facts? A fact is something that is known to have happened or to exist. It is something for which proof exists and about which there is information. It's indisputable. It's something that's there. You can't dispute it. That's what a fact is. So in this regard, and what Paul is dealing with, the church there, many of the members and the people there are asking him to give proof of who he was and why he is called to be an apostle, because many others had challenged his authority. Who is Paul? Why are you listening to him? You should come and follow me. We had that going on. Listen to previous studies and you'll get that. So it's a fact, though, an indisputable event, something that is known to have happened. Paul labored there in Corinth. That's a fact. He was the first to present the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ and the kingdom of our God to the believers there in Corinth and lead them to Jesus. It's a fact. It's indisputable. It happened. It is known to have happened. It's known to have existed. Paul did that. Another fact, the lives of the Corinthian believers have been transformed for good as a result of the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit. That's a fact. They could look at their own lives and say, hey, the way I used to live, I don't live anymore. What I used to do, I don't do anymore. Places I used to go, I don't go anymore. Things I used to say, I don't say anymore. Where I used to hang out, I don't hang anymore. Why? Because my life is made different in Christ. I have a new perspective and I can see the kingdom, whereas before I was blinded to the kingdom. So it's a fact. It's a fact now that they now have hope and eternal life in Jesus Christ. You see their lives. That's what it is. What are some other facts that we can even take personally and apply it? You and I have sinned. That's a fact. You and I sin. That's a fact. And you and I will sin. That's a fact. All right, so we're just talking about the facts right now. There's another fact in relation to that, that Jesus was born. That's a fact, right? Jesus lived and died. That's a fact. Jesus rose from the dead. That is a fact. A fact, again, is something that is known to have happened or to exist, something for which proof exists, yes, and about which there is information. Can't be disputed. So he's saying the facts of every case, any instant. So now he's talking about this and building this as if it's a case that's being presented against him. The facts of every case must be established. Okay, so facts or substantiated, before we even get to establish, the facts that are there, they are substantiated by two or three witnesses, right? those who see or hear firsthand and with eyewitness accounts or testimonies of occurrence. So the facts, that which has happened and that which has occurred, that's indisputable, is substantiated when you have someone present who has seen it with their own eyes or heard it with their own ears firsthand. Not somebody told me, you know, brother-in-law heard it from cousin and then they came and told me and I'm telling you about, no. That doesn't substantiate any facts right there, right? But those who have seen it or heard it firsthand, they were eyewitnesses of the account, and that makes them, and what they say, a testimony or a witness of the occurrence. So there are facts and witnesses that Paul had been in Corinth. You can ask the historians. They see evidence that Paul had been there. You can ask the historians again about what happened in Corinth. Not only was Paul present, but the people were there and the church was established. You have the facts that the disciples and those to whom he appeared and reveals himself. And that's talking about Jesus right there. But you also have facts of the witnesses that the Corinthian believers themselves, their lives, had been changed. We have the witnesses that they could speak for themselves about the transformation. We have the witness that Paul sees the transformation, and we also see the witness of God himself, that he has sealed them and he has come to dwell on the inside of them. It is a fact, you know, we mentioned that we sin. I sin, you sin, we have sinned, we will sin. But we also have this witness that you or anyone who was with you did it or thought it. Anyone who heard you, they are witnesses that you have sinned, that you do sin, and there will be a witness when you do sin, even if you try to cover it up. The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, he sees it all. All right? And then, but he says it has to be established. When you're talking about something being established, we're looking at it's accepted as proven. To discover or obtain proof of something. So to establish, and what he said, what did he say about being established? The facts must be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. It is set as proven. It's considered proven, and that there is proof. So looking at Paul's ministry, there is proof that the lives of the Corinthian believers were changed. We just said that a moment ago. We have proof that our lives have been changed because of Jesus's presence. We have, even though we sin, yes, there's proof that there is transformation. And then we look, we have evidence, and it is established and proven that Jesus lived and he lives among us and he is in the lives of his believers today. So that has been established. The proof has been established because there are witnesses. Say that with me. The proof has been established because there are witnesses to the fact. There are witnesses to the facts. So what is proof? A proof is a fact or a piece of information that reveals something exists or is true. The Corinthian believers, their changed lives authenticates Paul's ministry. The fact that they are made new gives authentication to Paul's ministry to them. And it also authenticates his position of authority in their lives. Jesus's death, burial, resurrection, and ascension to heaven, it paid the price for our sins. It exchanged life for the penalty of death. We were destined to die, but he exchanged life. There's the proof. And it frees me from the power of sin. So we have established the facts. We have established what established is, and we've established the proof. So now, after Paul says that, then he says, okay, we established the fact that this is going on. Now this is what I want you to do. With all of that, the proof, the evidence, I want you to examine yourself. To examine means to look through, to look at or consider a person or a thing carefully and in detail in order to discover something about them. So he's saying, I want you to look through yourselves and consider this. Look at your lives, Corinthians, and consider this. And he will speak to us today. Look at your life. And here's the question. Is your faith genuine? Do you have a genuine faith? He could ask me, Mark, do you have a genuine faith? Kim, do you have a genuine faith? Examine yourselves. Now, he's not talking about examine at the point of, are you saved? That's settled. But he's saying, are you or do you have genuine faith? If yes, if you do, then where did that come from? You got to look at it. Here's a scenario. They're saying, Paul's not an apostle. Paul's an imposter. Paul's not who he says he is. You don't have to listen to Paul. He says, is your faith genuine? Check your own lives. Examine your own lives. Has your life been changed? Is it really, really, really real? Then he says, if it did, where did that come from? And Jude gives some insight into that. The faith that you now have was delivered to you. Jude chapter 1, verse 3. Our faith is delivered unto us. Beloved, my whole concern was to write to you in regard to our common salvation, but I found it necessary and was impelled to write you and urgently appeal to you. This is the Amplified Classic Version, and exhort you to contend for the faith which was once for all handed down to the saints, the faith which is that sum of Christian belief which was delivered verbally to the holy people of God. So the faith, where'd your faith come from? Your faith was delivered to you. How was it delivered to you? I'm glad you asked that. Romans 10, 13 through 17 says, your faith came by hearing the word of God. For everyone, verse 13, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. But how can they call on him to save them unless they believe in him? How can they believe in him if they have never heard about him? And how can they hear about him unless someone tells them? And how will anyone go and tell them without being sent? That is why the scripture says, how beautiful are the feet of messengers who bring good news. But not everyone welcomes the good news, for Isaiah the prophet said, Lord, who has believed our message? Then verse 17 says this. So faith, how was the faith delivered to you? Faith comes from hearing, that is, hearing the good news about Christ. So he asks them, is Christ among you? Was the faith delivered to you? Do you have genuine faith? If you do, then is Christ among you? You should know this. And if Christ is among you, how so? So Paul is painting the picture. He says, how did you even hear this gospel? And if my life doesn't measure up, how does your life measure up? Because you got it from me. So examine yourselves, and in so, as you are examining yourself, you will see the authenticity of who I am. You will see that God has called me and positioned me and placed me in this position where I am in your life. So then he says, test yourselves. What is a test? It's a method of discovery by questions or practical activities. You get to know something by testing it. It's not just a pass or fail, but you get to understand how you think, what you do, and where you are in the process. So Paul says, if you pass the test of genuine faith, then surely you recognize that I am genuine and pass the test of apostolic authority by my position of influence and presence in your life. So then Paul closes it. Examine yourselves. It's not to examine to see if you're saved. It's examine that faith that you have. If you are in the faith, where did it come from? Paul says, it came from me. It came from the one who was sent to you. And I came bearing good news. And you heard that word. And because you heard that word, faith was deposited into you. And that's where you stand in genuine faith. So Paul closes this. His greeting says this. Verse 11 through 14. Dear brothers and sisters, I close my letter with these last words. And then be joyful, grow to maturity, encourage each other, live in harmony and peace. Then the God of love and peace will be with you. Verse 12, greet each other with a sacred kiss. 13, all of God's people here send you their greetings. Verse 14, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. So what does he say? Be joyful. Here's the question. We're in our cool down right now. As a believer, do you have joy? Is joy a part of your life? Grow to maturity is what Paul says. Are you growing and developing in your faith walk? Encourage each other is what he just said. Do you rejoice with others and push them on? Is that evident in your life? He says, live in harmony and peace. Do these things and God will be with you. So have you examined and tested your faith? That's the question to all of us. Have we examined and tested our faith? Are we in a true relationship with God through Jesus Christ? Are you experiencing, as he said at the close of this letter, are you experiencing the God of peace and love in your life? Are you experiencing the fellowship of the Holy Spirit? Have you called upon the name of the Lord? Jesus said, if you call, I will answer. If you come unto me, I will be there. He just says, repent, rethink, receive his forgiveness, accept his gifts, and expect his goodness. If you need to know Jesus, if you realize that you are not in faith, you're at the right place, at the right time, with the right people, with the right God. Let's pray so that you can have a relationship with Jesus. Father, I pray for those who may have come here this evening. They didn't know why they were coming. They just stumbled across it or they received an invitation. Jesus, I ask that you make yourself real to them. Reveal in this moment, Father, and remove any obstacles that would keep them from coming into relationship with you. If you're ready to make that decision, pray after me. Jesus, I realize that you're Lord. I realize that I need you. I realize that you gave your life so that I can have life. I receive it now, Jesus. I believe that you died for me. You were buried and you rose again, and you're now interceding for me in the heavens. I receive your life. I confess you at this moment as my Lord and Savior. If you've prayed that prayer, let us know in the chat and let us know that you want to walk with God, and we're going to celebrate with you and we're going to pray for you. Join us next time as we share from the Word. Thank you for joining us, and bring somebody with you. God bless you.